We'll have questions after that. Then we'll talk about the application, the logistics, all the links and things that go into the RFP, and then we'll have time for questions after that. Okay? Great. I'd like to introduce Paul Duncan. He'll talk about the program.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So we're going to go through these slides, and then I'll talk a little bit about what we're envisioning for this program. That way each of you has a better sense of what exactly we are expecting and looking for out of this program. So the purpose of this and the program overview is to utilize Measure H special funds from the County of Los Angeles to fund a single entity to engage, recruit, and establish relationships with landlords and property management companies to improve access to rental housing in the County of Los Angeles. Oh, there it goes. Sorry, bear with me, being finicky. This funding opportunity is open to private business entities, government agencies, and nonprofit organizations that must meet the following requirements: 3 years of experience in property management, real estate, business marketing, and or marketing research, 3 years of experience building and maintaining business relationship, and expertise in negotiating agreements, and then experience with database and or property management software. So unlike our typical RFPs, this RFP is open to for-profit entities, where typically we are only open to nonprofit entities. So we have opened up this one to have a larger pool than usual. Our current funding amount is approximately $2,760,000 a year, coming through Measure H Strategy E7. So our expectation with this funding is that whoever is selected as the provider to do the housing location will serve all spas throughout the county. This could be done in creating partnerships, so it does not mean that if you bid on it that you have to directly do those services. You could make a partnership with another entity or entities that serve other parts of the county. However, in your proposal, you will need to identify how you are going to be able to provide housing location services throughout the County of Los Angeles. The contract start date for this would be June 1st of this year. Some of the performance outcomes that we are looking for, as we go over this, realize that this is our first year, first time funding this, so we are looking at this as being, you know, our startup and really identifying how effective this program is going to be, learning best practices, working with you. One thing that we'll be doing through this throughout the first year and going forward is hosting a learning community. As part of that, we'll just kind of be learning what are some of the best practices, what should we be looking for, and really establishing ongoing expectations. So this first year will kind of be a baseline, but these are some of the areas that we are looking towards capturing and really being able to look at the success rate overall. So number of prospective properties marketed to for program participation, number of properties added to the CES system, so how many new properties that weren't participating with programs were you able to get into our system, the number of properties that agree to participate in a subsidized housing program for the first time, number of landlord outreach and other marketing events hosted and attended, number of total landlords participating, the number of new units available to match with homeless persons, number of total units available to match. So not just the new ones, but total. You may be working with people that have worked with CES system before, we'll also be looking at those. and then the length of time from unit availability to unit lease. The other thing that's not on here that is hard for you to control, but we'll be looking at it to judge and set a barometer for, is this actually being successful compared to what we were doing previously. We'll be looking at the time from a participant entering a permanent housing program, such as a rapid rehousing program, to the time that person leases up. Currently, when you look at our programs throughout Los Angeles County, we continue to see an upward trend in the amount of time from enrollment to time of lease up. Our hope with this program is that we can start to get people matched with housing at a quicker rate, and we can start to see that number go back down towards what we've seen in the past. So we will be looking at our trend from program enrollment to lease up in permanent housing. With this program, so that's our slides, but just to kind of walk through this program and what we're envisioning. Again, we're looking for a single entity that will take this contract. Our expectation is that that single entity will do a set of different things, from the more broad outreach strategy, creating a marketing platform for this program. So how are you going to engage landlords? Are you going to hold events? Are you going to, you know, come up with marketing materials? What is your plan to make sure that, you know, you're casting a wide net towards potential new landlords, not just through direct contact, but through some sort of marketing campaign? So we're looking for strategies on how you would do that. And then your strategies on how you're going to directly interact and work with landlords, how you're going to market this program once landlords have reached out to you. So what's your plan for engaging landlords and participating in this program, selling the program to them? And then from there, we're looking at how are you going to work also with RCS partners. So our expectation is that you are a partner with the other services we're funding. You need to be working with them to identify those landlords and match those participants and make sure that, you know, we are getting from those relationships into matches through RCS service providers. They're the ones that will be paying the rent to these owners, so having that relationship with them is going to be key. And then also your strategies for landlord retention. So yes, agencies are providing the services. However, we really see this program as that support to landlords. So, you know, if the landlord is, you know, having certain issues, you will be a person that they are most likely going to reach out to. How are you going to work with that landlord to resolve those issues? And that is also going to, again, fall back into working with the CES partners and ensuring that, you know, you have good relationships with them, that you're able to follow up when landlords are reaching out to you with issues, to have the case managers follow up and resolve certain issues that may be happening within their housing. So those are the main functions. Additionally, as asked in the experience, we are expecting that whoever is chosen for this maintains a database with the landlords that you are working with. We are asking that, you know, that be a somewhat open system, not completely open, but at least somewhat open to where RCS providers are able to see information within that. They are also able to identify landlords that they're working with through this database system, and that it can be a kind of a centralized repository for landlords, property management companies that are working with our homeless service providers. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Darcy to go through the threshold, and after that we'll have time for questions.
Thank you. Morning, Darcy Mulholland, Associate Director of Monitoring Compliance. I'm talking about the threshold review. So, for threshold review, proposers must submit a list of all core documents in order to be considered for this proposal. The core documents are listed on page 11 and 12 of your RFP, and we'll review them in a bit. For the financial stability, LASA will obtain financial data from audited financial statements or IRS tax forms in order to conduct the financial capacity assessment. So for agencies with budgets under $500,000, if audited financial statements are not available, LASA will accept financial statements review conducted and certified by an outside CPA for the last two fiscal years. For agencies with budgets over $501,000, LASA requires audited financial statements certified by a CPA for the last 2 years. And then for agencies with federal expenditures over $750,000, LASA requires audited financial statements certified by CPA for the last 2 years and accompanied single audit, if applicable, as required under the federal regulations. So we will review core documents. In addition, we'll review core documents such as fiscal policies and procedures, organizational charts, and actual RFP application, your answers to that, for details on accounting staff, accounting practices that include internal controls, compliance with GAAP and 2 CFR 200, We will also review your cost allocation plan regarding your methodology and procedures for allocating costs, direct and indirect, across multiple funding sources for various programs, grants, contracts, and agreements. Please make sure your cost allocation plan is detailed and lists all the funding sources that you have received and how you would allocate the shared costs across all of those contracts or all of those different funding sources. So if you do not submit the core documents necessary for the financial stability portion, you will not be scored that way. You will not be able to pass. So please make sure you submit all those documentation. So next. Okay. So list of core documents is on page 11 and 12. As a summation, ADA and ADA certification form, it's an actual form that you sign. Articles of incorporation, audited financial statements, as we just spoke of. If you're a for-profit vendor, you need to provide your audited financial report for each fiscal year for the last 2 years. IRS Form 990, if you're a for-profit, then your applicable IRS filing for the last 2 years. Please make sure you include certification of submission. Board of directors and trustee list. If you are applicable under the Nonprofit Integrity Act of 2004, then we also need the audit committee member and charter. That's if you have gross revenue above $2 million. Also, we need business licenses as applicable. California active business entity screenshot to actually say that you have active status. We need facility documentation, and the RFP lists out the different types of facility documentation you can provide. We need certification of the core documents. It's a form that you sign saying that you've uploaded all the core documents into FileShare. We need conflict of interest policy, the cost allocation plan, executive leadership and senior management team, resumes and short bios. This is how we see whether or not you have appropriate staffing to administer these funds or to have these funds. Financial policies and procedures. These are the ones we review for internal controls. We also need to see your financial management, procurement, cash distribution, cash management activities. Those should all be some of the financial policies and procedures you provide. Evidence of current assurance, including general liability and workman's comp. IRS exempt status. For-profits, provide your EIN number. We need organization budget that has been board approved. And if an organization budget is not available for for-profit entities, you can provide your annual report. We also need organizational charts that are detailed and list your staffing. This is how we confirm whether or not you have appropriate accounting staff. And then a complete list of current funding sources. You need to submit a grievance policy certification form and other types of applicable documents. And as it says here, you must submit all documents in order to be eligible. So please submit all documents, and please also, if you intentionally leave a document blank because it's not applicable, please include a document that has that information, the document name intentionally left blank, and include an explanation as to why that document is left blank or why it's not applicable to your contract. And that's it for my section. Thank you.
Great, so any questions? Please wait for the microphone so we can, because we're recording it. Any questions? We can do any questions on the threshold section first. Do you have questions on the threshold anyway?
No.
What do
you mean by the threshold?
The last section.
The last section, okay. Any questions on the program in general?
Hi, my name is Hugo Villa with the Village Family Services. We're the CES, the day CES for Spot 2. How many units are expected to get through this program?
So we are still working to establish a barometer for it, but our expectation that it's a significant number. So we're looking at somewhere around over an annual period that somewhere around 3,000 units would be identified.
And the other question that is puzzling me, what is the difference between the housing navigation and these? Because all CES have housing navigation that are doing, the navigators are doing these, pretty much.
This is not to work with people that we are serving. This is really meant to be that relationship of purely going out and finding.
Now, I understand, but the housing navigation also goes to find landlords and units.
We are expecting expertise and really looking at the real estate side of it and the negotiation of it, where our housing navigators, they're not typically salesmen. They're really people that are social workers, they're doing the case management, and they happen to need to go out and find properties because obviously our goal is housing. However, this is really looking at bringing in people with that expertise in negotiation of real estate property management type stuff. So we're really looking for that piece to be the focus versus in housing navigation. That is a function that's important, but it's not the main thing that people are hiring off of.
I'd like to add too that the additional items, you know, aside from housing navigation is the marketing. So having a marketing plan to landlords and also the database. So that's something housing navigators definitely, I don't think, are doing.
Hi, my name is Sandra Schmidt. I'm with the LA County Housing Authority. I have two questions. The first one is, if you already receive Measure H funding, is that a disqualification for this program?
That is not a disqualification. So you can already be receiving Measure H funding through various different other strategies.
And second question, what service providers are in the CES? What kind of subsidized housing are we looking at?
So this program would mostly be working with two different programs. So one would be our rapid rehousing providers. So those are typically our agencies that are out there that have a short to medium term rental assistance attached to them and are helping people get that. There's no housing subsidy or long term permanent housing subsidy attached to them. They're meant to be anywhere from 3 months to a year in time duration. And then the other main program that it would be working with is our permanent supportive housing programs. Those different across the board. This would really be obviously focusing on the tenant-based housing versus the project-based housing. So working with tenant-based housing programs, we have a wide range of different tenant-based housing programs that are out there providing permanent supportive housing through many different housing authorities. So people may be receiving their actual certificate through different housing authorities, so being able to know and understand different processes for the landlords receiving approval through the housing authorities would be important to know, and being able to know, are there differences in the payment rates for those different housing authorities as they're going out and engaging landlords.
Thank you.
I have sort of a three-parter related to this. Will eligible agencies, competitive agencies, be expected to identify housing partners, the agencies they're going to be working with up front, or will that be part of their implementation rollout? That's one part. Two, if it's not required up front to identify those people as part of this application process, is it an expectation that there will be some sort of engagement process with service agencies down the road, and what does that look like? And three, how do we know as service partners that, the access to those 3,000 units is going to be equitable, going to be spread out across spas, and that people are going to have just a chance to have their people placed in some of those 3,000 units if it's not part of this upfront process?
So we are not requiring it as a part of the upfront process to go out and establish a agreement with each of the CES areas. I would encourage you, if you don't already have a relationship as you're, you know, going through this process, to reach out to at least the lead CES agencies in each of the 8 service planning areas to just establish a conversation and make sure, like, you know, that would strengthen your proposal if you are able to say, you know, we've had initial conversations with the various coordinated entry system leads. If you don't know who they are by chance, you can always go on to the LASA website, and if you go under the provider section, you're able to find a list of the CES leads and contacts for those. I would encourage you to reach out and begin negotiation with them. If you are looking to partner to be able to cover the full county, then you do need to identify who those partners would be in your application. If you are relying on them in order to cover the full county, you can add on subcontractors after the fact if you are selected. However, as much as possible, we ask that you identify them in your bid. That way we understand how you're going to provide these services. And then lastly, on how we are going to ensure. So LASA is in the process of hiring a housing location coordinator. They will be working with the selected contractor on a regular basis and identifying and monitoring, are you finding units throughout the county? Are there areas where we're seeing that units aren't being located, and we'll work with you in a conversation of what's happening, and we'll be monitoring to ensure that efforts are being made to engage each area and to have some equitability in how the resources through this program are implemented in the community. We understand that there may be challenges on full equitability. Finding landlords that are willing to work with the program in, you know, Spa 5 West LA is going to be harder than finding landlords in Spa 1 Antelope Valley. So it may be hard to fully be equitable, but we want to make sure that effort is being made to at least engage landlords and find landlords throughout the county.
This is also a two-part question. So I just want to confirm, LASA is looking to fund one entity for the whole county?
We are looking to fund one entity for the whole county. That entity could choose to, you know, bring in additional partners and subcontract to cover the whole county. But we are looking to fund one provider, one contract to do this.
And just out of curiosity, what was the idea behind funding one entity versus regionally based, like, housing location teams?
So we debated back and forth on this for a while. There, again, we could have gone with two approaches. One which we chose as a centralized versus having regional. At the end of the day, in conversations and looking at stuff, we chose to go with a single entity to really be able to centralize this, create a standard, and ensure that, you know, there is a centralized database, that resources are being shared throughout the county, and that really this is a centralized program, that's one function is housing location, therefore ensuring that they have a clear focus on partnering with the all agencies that are being funded, and not just ensuring that it doesn't happen where an entity in a certain region is only focusing on getting their participants linked with the housing resources. So that is why we chose to go with a single entity.
So I'm wondering, as far as having the landlords come to this entity with their issues with the newly leased up tenants, you would conceivably be hiring some type of staff, like a permanent liaison between the landlords and the service agencies that you're working with, sort of on the back end to deal with these, like, sort of case management issues for these tenants. Would that be, what's the long-term expectation for that sort of role?
So the long-term expectation is really that you're there and available if the landlord is having an issue. Obviously, the expectation is not that you jump in and solve the issue that's happening with the participant that's been placed in that unit, but that you follow up with the service provider and say, hey, we're being reached out to by this landlord. Can you please make sure that you're following up with the landlord, that you're addressing the issues with the participant? If you've reached out to that agency and they're not being responsible, you can escalate it to LASA's housing location coordinator, who would then work with the LASA team to ensure that we're following up with that agency and that it is being addressed. We want to continue to see that landlords have a voice, they have a place to go, and feel that as a system we are being responsive, as that has been challenges at moments.
Good morning. I wanted to know, would ADU housing be considered as alternative housing for homeless?
What does that acronym stand for?
I'm sorry. It's called accessory dwelling units.
Oh. Accessory dwelling units would be an acceptable placement for somebody experiencing homelessness through one of these programs. The programs that are being funded through the county typically have a requirement that that accessory dwelling unit at least meets habitability standards and is rent reasonable. So you could work with people in those accessory dwelling units as long as it met the standards of the programs.
My second question, I do a lot of legal advocacy for uninhabitable housing in the AB. Due to us having no rent control, which impact our homeless population as well as our zero to low income that has an annual income under, I would say, $12,000. What are we doing? What is LASA doing, or what are we doing as advocates for homeless to address the issue that there need to be a cap on rent to assist us with housing?
So that is outside of, that's more of a political question to a degree.
I don't like politics.
There is, you know, and a serious challenge with the affordability of housing and working with participants that are low income. There are a couple things that are in the process of being done to address some of this. One thing that's being done, there will be an RFP released next month for a shallow subsidy program that's going to partner with our rapid rehousing programs for people that don't need ongoing case management, that need, you know, some rental assistance. So that's one thing that we're looking at. The incorporation of shared housing, so working with owners that may want to rent out a 4 or 5 bedroom house and are open to having one person per room, two persons per room, and working with an agency that's, you know, interested in and working on shared housing to kind of reduce some of that cost. Those are a couple of the strategies that are being done. As far as rent control, that is not within loss's necessary realm, so I can't really speak to what the push is being done for that.
Thank you.
Any other questions? All right, we'll move on to the next section, and we'll have another opportunity for questions at the end if you think of anything else.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Adriana Orlas, the procurement analyst here at LASA. I'm going to be going over the quality review. The quality review is going to be evaluated by five categories, which is professional qualifications, program design, program readiness, CES alignment, and program budget. Each proposal will be receiving a score out of 100. For the program qualification, it is out of 30 points. We will be assessing your experience with in property management, real estate, or market research, your experience with database or property management software, your experience working with tenant laws and habitability inspections, financial checks and check cutting processes, data collection, and program evaluation. For the program design, it is out of 25 points, and this will be assessing the strength of implementation plan, long-term sustainability, the strength of plan to outreach and market to landlords, your ability to build and maintain relationships, the procedures to identify and resolve conflicts between tenants and landlords. For the program readiness, it is out of 25 points, and we will be evaluating the ability to your organization to start the program by the contract start date, which is June 1st of 2018. Mm-hmm. For the CES alignment, it's your knowledge of the coordinated entry system and the plan to work within the system. So this is out of 10 points. And Miriam will be going over the program budget.
I'm not very good at using this. Can you guys hear me?
Okay.
So I'll be talking to you guys about the budgets this morning that are required as part of your proposal. It's required to submit a competitive budget for a 12-month contract, and I have a handout in the back of how to download the template that's required to be submitted. I can go over the step-by-step, but I don't know if we have access to the website here.
We do.
Okay.
You could go this section. You can talk about how we're evaluating the budget.
Okay.
And then we can
go back.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'll skip down to the part about actually going through the budget template. So when you download the budget template, you'll find that it's broken down by a funding source, and it's listed out with the eligible activities that you're able to allocate the funding for. You are not required to have, but it's encouraged to have, leverage for your program. the higher your leverage, the higher you'll score during the quality reviews. If you do list leverage on your budget, documentation to support that leverage is required to be submitted via file share, and acceptable documentation would include a contract, a copy of the check, a commitment letter, or an MOU. LASA will reimburse up to 12% of the funded portion of the program that LASA covers. And also on the budget template, you'll need to include justifications for all the allocations that you have listed. I'll talk a little bit about scoring. I know that that was briefly covered. There are four sections that we score under when we look at a budget that's submitted with a proposal. One is leverage. And so, like I said, it's not a requirement, but it's highly recommended because you'll score better if you have that. Cost effectiveness. So, for example, like a cost per client ratio. So the more cost effective you are, the higher you'll score. Accuracy, such as did you include all the required services on your budget? Are all the costs that you included, that you allocated on your budget, are they eligible activities? And justifications, just providing adequate detail on the costs that you have listed on the detail budget. Any questions?
We do have another section where Miriam can actually pull up the budget if you want to do it. Right now, you can do it later.
Okay.
Right now. So if you have questions, we'll go through actually like all the actual links on the website, and Miriam can pull up a budget. But does anyone have any questions about the quality review section or about how we'll review the application, how we'll review the budget?
Hi, you mentioned that the budget is a 12-month budget, even though this is a multi-year proposal.
Do you want me to talk about that?
Yeah.
Yes, that's true. Please submit 12-month budgets because that will allow us to compare your budgets to one another. That's the easiest way to compare budgets. The contract term will be until, I think it's the end of 2020, but funding authorizations are only for 1 year. So if you're awarded the contract, your contract will start June 1st, but you'll only have funding authorization for 1 month because of the way our fiscal year runs, and then you'll get an amendment, and then you'll have another 12-month authorization. But to simply answer your question, yes, please submit a 12-month budget. Any other questions on that section? No? Okay. Okay, now we'll have some time. Okay, go ahead.
I'm so sorry.
You also mentioned that there's a cost effectiveness per client, but when I asked the question about how many units were expected, you mentioned that 3,000 units. So how many clients per units are we, I mean, how do we do a cost effectiveness based on the number of clients when we're talking about units?
So there's a couple different ways that we can look at this, depending on how specific you get into your budget. Obviously, This is a little bit of a harder area to fully judge because there's different ways that you can look at it. We will try to pick a way that, as much as possible, we can look at across your different things. How many staff that you're going to be proposing to hire, how many units. And we're going to look also at reasonableness just because, I mean, you could propose that, you know, with this $2,700,000, we're going to find, you know, 20,000 units. Yeah, that may be the most cost effective, but it may not be realistic as well. So we'll also be looking along with your cost effectiveness that there, you've detailed it out to where it does also seem like, you know, that the ratio is realistic. So in your proposal, you should be saying how many units that you're looking to ultimately get over the year. Our goal is somewhere around 3,000. You could propose what you feel is reasonable with the amount of money, as well as what your staffing plan is with that money. So if you said, I'm going to hire, you know, five staff with my 2.7 million, it's not very cost effective, versus if you said you were going to hire 30 people with this. So that's another area that we'll look at for cost effectiveness, is your actual staffing plan for this, along with how many people you're saying you're going to serve.
So I'm going to be going over how to complete application. So to submit a complete application, you will consist of the following. It will consist of the following items: opening an application, submitting a program profile, submitting a subcontractor program profile uploaded to FileShare, and submitting a budget template uploaded to FileShare, and required documents submitted to FileShare. If you log in to your If you go to our main webpage, you will click on the top where it says providers, and it will take you to our procurement schedule. And right, you can click where it says 2018 Housing Location Service Program, and you'll be able to see the RFP timeline. If you scroll down, you can see where it says My Org Application. You can click on that link, and it will take you to the application. So you would just start your application. I have already filled an application out, so we can go straight to the program profile. Just when you open up your application, make sure you write down your application ID in case you need to refer back to your application. Say you don't finish your application and you want to reopen your application. Make sure you have that. It will be easier for you to find your application. So you enter your program name, your address, the spot you will be servicing, answer all the questions, and when you answer all the questions, at the bottom, make sure you check the box to certify your application and click where it says submit. But when you submit your application, you will get a message directing you to your program profile. In case you want to, you don't want to work on your program profile right away, you can always go back to the RFP timeline and click on the program profile. Or another way that you can go about it is click where it says log into your My Org. Click on the My Org, and on the right side, click where it says Forms and Application, and this is where you can see your submitted applications and your draft applications. So and for your program profile, this is for the subcontractor program profile, and for your program profile, you can click on the link. So So we, if you download the PowerPoint presentation, it also has the link where you can access your program profile. Now I'm going to hand it over to Miriam to go over the algebra activities and the budget.
On these two items briefly when I was up here. So the first slide that we have up here are the eligible activities under this RFP. So as I had mentioned, LASA funding should only be allocated to the eligible activities included on this slide. Kind of a screenshot of what a budget detail looks like once you've downloaded it from the website. On the left-hand side, you'll see all the actual eligible activities. So if you're going to have a database management person and all the fringe benefits or any other costs that are allocated with that and so forth. So each of those categories would be one of these activities up here. The columns at the top list out the funding sources, so this particular RFP is covered by E7, Measure H. You can't see it on this slide, but...
Open the note.
Yeah. Is it here?
Yeah.
Let me see if I can get it over here. The download button.
Scroll down.
Oh, here. So you'll all receive like a little short form. Ooh, this is huge. Hold on. An allocation like this as one of your tabs, and that lists out the program component and the funding source. That's kind of like a little summary for you guys. And then the detail budget is here. Let me make it smaller. And this is the portion that you couldn't see before in the snapshot that I had earlier, the justification section for each of the costs. So if you put in costs for this position right here, have some kind of justification like for the FTE or something like that over on the right hand side. And this will have your total award amount or the proposed amount that you would like to be awarded, and you should have that total to the bottom as well. And your leverage would be listed here. So your total program cost would be M. So this would be LASA. This would be, if you have somebody else covering costs, this would be the total of it.
Any questions?
Now I'll just go over some of the timeline. Today is the mandatory proposers conference. Please make sure you all sign in. Written questions are due by February 23rd at 2 p.m. Our funding team is not allowed to answer any questions outside of today and outside of our email address. So please submit any questions to our email address before that time, and we will publish all of the questions. We will also post the recording of this webinar. If you have any technical issues, with the application or the links, you can contact our IT team, and that is websupport@lhasa.org. So a separate process from our team here. Our email is not listed here, but it's definitely on the website, fundingopportunities@lhasa.org. That, please submit any questions about the RFP, about the program. If you think of questions later, submit those to us and we'll respond to in writing so everyone has the same answers to all the questions. The deadline is March 16th at 2 p.m. The threshold and quality review approval will happen during April, and contracts are scheduled to start June 1st. These are all the links that we showed you today. They're all on that page, the Housing Location Services page on our website. And they're right there, is IT issues. Emails are right there. That's the end of our presentation. Are there any final questions? No? Okay. And Miriam has some handouts on the back that weren't on the table outside. So the handouts about the budget are in the back. You can get those from her. Thank you all for coming.
Very glad.